Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to another video. If you woke up today and saw some blood in the markets and a hurting portfolio, you are not alone. Within the last 24 hours, we saw the crypto market crash with Bitcoin breaking support and free falling back to $42,000. But could this be the last opportunity to get into crypto before it moons this coming quarter four? Or are we headed to another crypto flash crash? And is this the start to the crypto winter? In this video, we'll be going over three reasons why the market crashed, some major key dates to look out for during this week, and talk about how you can also beat any market crash just by watching this video all the way till the end. Now, before we get started, like the usual, don't forget to drop a like down below. And today's video was also brought to you by Crypto.com. Crypto.com has over 10 million users and allows you to buy, sell, and trade cryptocurrencies at true cost. You can also earn 8 to 14% back on select cryptocurrencies by staking them through the app. Crypto.com has also partnered up with Visa to allow you to make purchases using their debit card, where you can essentially get free Spotify, Netflix, and Amazon Prime, depending on how much you stake using their card. Now, big shout out to Crypto.com for being an active sponsor for this channel. I personally like working with them because they're very easy to work with, unlike many other brands. And they also recently signed a deal with the UFC, and I can actually see if they are interested in hooking up any of our viewers with some free UFC Crypto.com related merch or tickets, because they do indeed have the plug. Now, ladies and gents, with all that being said, let's hop into the computer and get you some knowledge for today. All right, so the global crypto market cap is sitting today at under $2 trillion. It is down about 9% in the overall market, with Bitcoin's dominance going up. So we're seeing a lot of altcoins liquidating their positions. What you'll notice is that Bitcoin today is now at $43,746, down about 8.29% for the day, with many altcoins trailing behind. So Ethereum actually hasn't dumped as much as other altcoins have. We're really in a similar range within the top 4 to 5 altcoins here, aside from Tether. But as you see, we go down the list, you'll notice that the percentage might go up even more. So during times like this, with my normal trading strategy, I prefer to dollar cost average every single day into Bitcoin. Whenever I see a large opportunity with Bitcoin maybe being down just about 8%, but say as an example, Avalanche is down about 18.63%, that transfer right there is going to allow me to buy the dip further, a little bit more arbitrage, thus giving me more buying power with the amount that I initially invested into the crypto market. Towards the end of the video, like I said, we will talk more about some strategies that you can also utilize in order to profit big in this market. But first, let's actually talk about why in the world did the market dump? We recently had the Golden Cross. We've been having a good string of events. The regulations haven't been going crazy, but you guys also need to realize that some significant events have been taking place as well. All right, so first things first, I believe one of the most important articles to cover is going to be the situation regarding Evergrande in China. Now, this situation can be semi-complicated in its whole, but I actually found a really good Twitter thread breaking down exactly the background of this and talking about the details regarding this incident here. So to begin, they state, Evergrande is the train wreck that the financial world and media can't help but watch. Here's a breakdown on the story. So the Evergrande Group is a Fortune 500 real estate developer with headquarters in Shenzhen, Guangdong, China. If you guys aren't familiar with that area, back when I actually used to do e-commerce and I was working very closely with a lot of these manufacturing factories, this is actually one of the provinces in China where they hold about 60,000 factories. They're actually known more specifically in this area to be a center of technology and economic development. So it's not surprising that they are based in this area. And you also notice here, they state every day they produce some $300 million worth of goods and account for about 30% of China's exports and 1/3 of the world's production of shoes, textiles, and toys. It's a big business. As recently as 2020, it had sales of $100 billion and adjusted core profits of $5 billion. At its core, it's a home builder business. It's a website that states it has over 1,300 projects across 280 plus cities, but it has pushed the boundaries, making investments in EVs, an internet and media production company, a theme park, a soccer club, and a mineral water company. As a developer, Evergrande had to contend with a highly cash-consumptive growth profile. Building a new project may take many months and requires a lot of cash outflows along the way. Cash collections from buyers come later, with the exception of smaller upfront deposits. So how did Evergrande fund its impressive growth? debt. It borrowed aggressively, even by real estate property development standards. And you guys, if you remember anything at all about the 2008-2009 financial crisis, you'll know that a lot of this starts with over leverage or debt. This has been a trend even within the crypto industry. A few weeks ago, we had over leveraged traders that got liquidated that forced the last crash in the market as well. So let's continue this. It became the world's most heavily indebted developer with a debt load of over $100 billion and over $300 billion in liabilities. You'll see with this pie graph right here that 54% or a majority is going to be secured bank and other borrowings. He also states Evergrande was largely indifferent to pricing on the land it was purchasing, knowing that the risk would be passed off to banks financing the purchases. The debt-fueled growth propelled Evergrande and its billionaires into an elite class. It entered the Fortune 500 at number 496 in 2016 and reached 122 by the latest ranking. But debt is a double-edged sword, and Evergrande was due to catch the other edge. As its debt burden grew, so did the interest payments on that debt. This is mostly fine so long as revenues and profits with which you can make these payments continue to grow. But if the growth or profitability slows or government restricts borrowing, it is not fine. Imagine a metaphorical boa constrictor tightening its grip on its prey. You can try to borrow to make more payments, but that only fuels the snake. Moreover, the knowledge of your precarious position increases risk and makes that borrowing more challenging and costly. In Evergrande's case, the snake tightened its grip in 2020. It had its first major liquidity scare, a potential inability to meet its liabilities, thus sending a letter to the local government warning that an upcoming payments could cause a crisis with systemic financial sector risks. As with most deleveraging spirals, there is a technical side, inability to make payments, and a psychological side, the knowledge of instability impacting your market standing. The psychology is damning. Reports of the letters sent Evergrande stocks and bonds tumbling. The short-term crisis was avoided. An investor group didn't force a big repayment, but the long-term remained. Dornbush's law says that crises take longer to happen than you expect, but then happen faster than you could have ever imagined. This proved true for Evergrande. To meet its ever-growing obligations, Evergrande began tapping into creative financing strategies. It pushed employees to provide short-term loans to the company, which is absolutely crazy, which it called high-interest investments in order to ensure they received their year-end bonuses. And this article proves that. So Evergrande gave workers a choice: loan us cash or lose your bonus. Jeez. But the company quickly fell behind, missing payments earlier this month and leaving thousands of employees in a lurch. With over $7.4 billion of bond payments due in 2022 and large interest payments coming up as soon as this Thursday, the crisis appears to be accelerating. Continuing down, he states, to reiterate, the psychological side is just as impactful as the technical. It was recently reported that Evergrande was offering to sell products at a deep discount, indicating a fire sale required to make its payments and sending further panic spiraling into the market. Protests have broken out at Evergrande's offices in China, with up to 1 million homebuyers left in a devastating limbo, having paid deposits up front for homes that may never be built. The media narrative cycle of demise ramped up in earnest and further fueled the fire. Importantly, the Evergrande situation poses a systematic risk to the Chinese economy, with deep ties to the financial institutions and working class consumers across China. A disorderly collapse would have far-reaching impacts. So we're looking at the crypto market now. We're also seeing a tumble in the stocks as well. But China is caught in a very tough spot. Act quickly with a bailout and be viewed as condoning the financial excess that led to the problem, or fail to act and allow the collapse to ripple through the entire economy that is just recovering from COVID shocks of 2020 and 2021. The Evergrande situation will undoubtedly continue to play out in public in the days and weeks to come. So markets will now be watching for whether the People's Bank of China will inject liquidity tactically Wednesday night. MN says the timing of all this comes as some investors are also bracing for a potential hawkish outlook from the Federal Reserve on Wednesday, and many have been waiting for a significant pullback in the S&P during the months of September. So this week is definitely going to be crucial whether you are invested into crypto or stocks. I do believe that we are going to see some pretty huge volatility. Now, if you're wondering how come a story like this out of China is impacting the crypto markets so much, and this is because China has always had a direct hand over crypto. If you guys remember the mining incident when Chinese miners are getting banned and forced out of China in order to resume their involvement with the crypto market. If you guys remember closely, we did see a large tumble in the price as well. And whenever we get a lot of uncertainty in the actual traditional market of investments, that's when many investors tend to sell off their investments, holding more cash, getting ready for any type of explosion or possible correction or pop in the market. Now, the Evergrande situation segues pretty well into the second reason why the market took a tumble. And this is because the FOMC press conference date is coming up very soon. So if you guys had watched my major crypto dates video that I posted about 2 weeks ago, you would have been prepared for the situation. I mentioned in this video here to make sure you mark in your calendars or you're very aware of these dates coming up, because historically in the past, every time we get a meeting date, we see volatility in the market, which opens up opportunity or it can save you money as an investor. So I'm going to play this clip from this video right here, just so you guys can get a little bit of confirmation of what we've been talking about over the past few weeks. It's coming up like September 21st to September 22nd for the next FOMC meeting with Jerome Powell is going to be important, not just for the stock market, but we're also seeing the ladder of the crypto market being affected as well. So the third reason why the crypto markets took a tumble today was because of pure whale and crypto manipulation. So manipulation happening in the crypto industries is not outlandish at all. We actually get manipulation across most investment sectors, and we've seen it traditionally before in the past with stocks, with pump and dumps, with the SEC trying to come in and regulate it. With cryptocurrency, because we are still very early and we don't have as much regulation as the stock market does with a lot of these public companies, you can find more manipulation going on, but sometimes you can actually use this to your advantage. With the way crypto and blockchain technology works, you can actually get an idea of all the larger whale purchases going on in the market. This is called on-chain analysis, and this is why I like to focus on different metrics of research in order to gauge a better full picture on what's really happening in the market. So this is a quick article called Spotting the Five Common Crypto Price Manipulation Patterns. I'm not going to go deep into this just because I want to stay more relevant to the topic of today's video, but I wanted to point out just a couple key points from here. So in the introduction, they state market manipulation has existed for as long as tradable assets have existed, and cryptocurrencies are no exception to it. The cryptocurrency space is also immature, with nascent regulations making it vulnerable to market manipulations not easily possible within mature markets. In this article, he states, I will dive into some of the common market manipulation techniques, identify patterns around it, and equip people to spot abusive behavior. So he states, pump and dumps, the most pervasive technique used in the crypto market today is simply just a pump and dump. You've seen this happen a lot with altcoins that have smaller market caps, where if you invest less into it, you can further manipulate the entire cryptocurrency or that token. So we've had this happen many, many times. And many times you'll hear them as rug pulls, because what ends up happening is investors who get in on the project early will then shill it, pump it up, or have YouTube bots spamming my YouTube videos with some of these lower cap altcoins, get you to invest thinking it's a good idea, and then they pull the rug under you once it starts to escalate in price. We've seen this happen with, as an example, Shiba Inu, Dogelon, just any cryptocurrency that was known as the meme coin related to Doge. It just happened time and time again. This is why on this channel, we focus on cryptocurrencies that have real utility, fundamental value, that has long-term partnerships and investor backing. So regardless of whatever happens in the market, we still have the basis. We have the foundation, we have the defense, we have the support, and we have the upside, so you guys can come out profitable. Second, they also mention the whale wall, which is another common technique, and this is used to be frequently visible in prior Bitcoin cycles, somewhat less prevalent, but still happens on shady exchanges. In the old economy, this technique used to be called order book spoofing. It's a tactic where a market participant will place a large set of orders with no intention of ever having executed. The intent is to create the illusion of large demand or supply in the market. Order book spoofing was used in the commodities market in the past, and even in reputable old economy institutions have been in trouble for executing these techniques. Wash trading is also another whale wall technique, and it's used to create an illusion of an active market for a specific asset, just like other tactics. It's illegal to do this in more mature old economy financial markets, but appears to be fair game on the crypto turf as of now. So the next tactic is actually called stop hunting, and this happened in the most recent crypto market crash a few weeks back. So this is one of the most nefarious tactics, and what ends up happening is whenever you're able to see on-chain data or see all the extra over-leveraged positions, what whales can do is actually drive the prices of cryptocurrencies down. So this is used to force action from market participants out of their positions by driving prices low enough to trigger their stops. The motivation for whales is to pick up the asset at a lower price once multiple participants' hand is forced out. So I believe this is actually one of the more common metrics that we've seen, especially play out with Bitcoin. So last but not least, one of the most commonly used manipulation tactics are going to be related to FUD. If you've heard of FUD on this channel or any other YouTube channel or even on the news, this stands for fear, uncertainty, and doubt. And this is one of the most effective manipulation techniques as they claim to move crypto assets without ever buying or selling a coin. So the reason why FUD has such a drastic impact on the market is because it shakes up investors and you get this mass effect. So anytime we get fake news or fake narratives, we see the price of cryptos either mooning or tanking. And if whales are able to do that in a predictive measure, they're going to be able to make a ton of money and either liquidate and ruin people's lives, or they're going to be able to make a tremendous amount of money. Regardless, whenever this happens, it creates extreme volatility in the market, which is oftentimes not good for newer investors. All right, so here's a perfect example of FUD in the market. So you'll notice that Litecoin had this insane green candle right here where the price jumped anywhere from 12 to 20% in a single day before it pumped back down. So this looks like a pump and dump, right? But it actually started with FUD in the market. So this is fear, uncertainty, and doubt, because they claimed that Walmart was actually going to accept Litecoin as a crypto payment, and almost immediately they came out and said that that wasn't true. That wasn't the news. Who started that article? Well, pretty much whenever this happens and Litecoin had that spike up, it liquidated any investors. It triggered alerts, and whales were able to dump their positions at the top, leaving newer people holding the bag. So this is just an example of what could happen in a market whenever we get false narratives, or what they claim in this article, half-truths or fake narratives created around a specific project or asset so that you can see a large price impact. Sell the rumor, buy the news, false propaganda. These are all different traits under the umbrella of fear, uncertainty, and doubt within the crypto market. Now, in addition to that, just less than a day ago, we actually had word from Bitcoin.com that US authorities are investigating Binance for insider trading and market manipulation. This will just further reiterate my point that market manipulation is real. It does happen. Now, with this, we do have to wait to see more type of news circulating just to make sure we get all points on this. But Binance did come out with a statement, and they said, at Binance, we have a zero tolerance policy for insider trading and a strict ethical code related to any type of behavior that could have a negative impact on our customers or industry. Now, I'm really curious to see how this story develops, because Binance, I know, has been doing their best attempt in order to stay within the guidelines of the trading industry. And I just wouldn't be surprised if this is additional FUD as well in order to drive prices of the crypto market down, when in reality, CZ, their CEO, has been very active in working alongside regulators. And you'll know that this is why you have like Binance.com and then Binance.us. You have many different versions of this company because they are still trying their best to stay as the top exchange for cryptocurrencies. All right, so in terms of key important dates that you have to know, we have the FOMC meeting coming very, very soon. Wednesday, we're going to get more word on what may happen with the whole Evergrande situation going on in China, whether they're going to continue to add more money. But another key date that nobody seems to be talking about, even still, I mentioned a lot of this in my last video. So if you guys watch my last upload before I took the weekend off, you'll notice that I was having a little bit more skepticism in the market moving forward and talking about the point of making sure you lock in those profits, because once these dates approach, that's when I expect to see that volatility where it could save you money in this market. So over 60 South Korean crypto exchanges are set to suspend services next week. They posted this on Friday, and this date is supposed to be September 24th. And this is going to have a huge impact, because this is going to be hundreds of billions of dollars that could get liquidated off or transferred off these exchanges. And what you have to know about all this right now is that South Korea is going through some very heavy regulation as well. While the whole world focuses on everything, all the craziness going on, you got to focus on this date, which is also going to be Friday. So this Wednesday and Friday, crypto is going to have one hell of an exciting week. We're just going to have to see what happens. I did see a more recent article talking about how the Korean government says 28 crypto crypto exchanges have met preliminary requirements to continue their operations. So according to this article, you can get a better idea that many of these exchanges are working around the clock right now to meet those regulatory requirements to stay open past September 24th. All right, so in this portion of the video, let's finally cover the topic of how you can successfully beat this market crash. So we talk about anytime we get a dip in the market, we are almost always going to see a quick bounce up, because whenever whales add large positions to it, it just drives the price up and you can get a clear indication of the floor. So as a trader, this is when technical analysis comes more into play. You can just take a look at the charts right here and see that the bottom was maybe just a few hours ago this morning at 8 a.m. Eastern time before we had that quick bounce up. But like I predicted, so I actually mentioned this in our Discord over in our Patreon. I opened some additional spots for you guys to join as well too. But this time, unlike the last liquidation with Bitcoin where we saw the price rise up very quickly, the bottom always flattens out and we get a quick bounce up, but that doesn't mean that it's going to fully have a V-shaped recovery that many other traders are expecting. In my opinion, this week is going to be more relatively flat just because of all the uncertainty and doubt that we have in the market coming out with all this fundamental news that we just covered earlier in this video. For me right now, you still have a great opportunity to buy up this dip if you do believe that Bitcoin is going to hit at least 60, 65, 70, or even $100,000 earlier this year. There's also an idea that this could be the one final dip before we go into quarter four and we have the explosion that many investors are anticipating. Even today, with the amount of volatility that we're seeing, if you're able to buy the dip at around $42,000, then you could find yourself profitable all day today. That right here is considered a quick day trade or even a swing trade position or entry point, or you could just find yourself reducing the average cost on your longer positions. So the question is, Brian, how in the world do we time these bottoms? How do you do it? And how can I best improve my chances the next time we have a market dip? And here's what you need to know. Now, just as an example, Bitcoin is down about 7% today. You'll notice that most altcoins are either going to match that or be more in terms of a price dip. So I'm still a very strong believer that you can still make a lot more money with other altcoins. Bitcoin dipped about 7% today, but Polkadot is down about 13%. You'll notice that other additional altcoins are going to have more of a sale if you do believe the market is going to continue to increase in price. Now, another metric to look at is going to be the moving averages. If I go on bar chart, I can see that for Bitcoin, it's going to be $42,862 for the 50-day, the 100-day, it's going to be $41,000, and the 200-day is going to be $43,207. You can take any one of these moving averages. I personally prefer the 200-day moving average and find that anything under $43,000 is going to be a good entry point. Now, in addition to that, most cryptocurrencies have what you call a psychological floor price. So this actually happens at every even number threshold. So as an example, Bitcoin's going to be $40,000. Ethereum's going to be under $3,000. Cardano's going to be under $2. Anytime Cardano, say as an example, went under $2, to me, that's an immediate buy because I know that whales are going to pick that up instantly and that is going to be free money right there for you. This is why you always want to have cash on the sideline. If Ethereum went below $3,000, which it actually did today, it got picked up very, very quick. So I know it seems almost too easy, seems almost too simple because you have a lot of these technical analysis that are drawing crazy triangles and patterns, but sometimes it's just as easy as that. Even within today, within the last day, Bitcoin dipped to $2,949, under $3,000, that flat level of $3,000. And almost instantly, this crypto got bought up and now it's sitting at $3,100 for this day. Very, very quick movement. We can see this happening with Bitcoin as well too. And with the market cap that it currently has, you got to notice that's a lot of people buying the dip once it nears the bottom. So Bitcoin necessarily didn't go towards $40,000. That would have broken crazy resistance level. But this is why I also look at those moving averages. And this was still under the 200-day. And right now, Bitcoin is right above it, $44,000. Quick, easy dip right there. So use the moving averages, a very easy indicator. And also take a reminder of the floor price or the support levels for even numbers with cryptocurrencies. If you're able to do that consistently whenever the market dips and you're able to get in early and take those profits off the table as well, you will leave as a successful investor. You will make money in this cycle here. Now, I don't think this strategy is going to be the best for the next crypto bull run, but at least for now, whatever market cycle we've been in, if you have been able to take those profits off the peak of the market, we've had so much volatility swings and we've had numerous amount of crashes where you would be able to make your money tenfold compared to long-term hodlers, which is somewhat what I'm still doing. Now, you know, my situation is going to be very different from anyone who has more time in actively trading. I personally like to hodl and not worry about finding the arbitrage unless the swing trades are very, very clear for me. But I personally like to just hold, forget about it, accumulate long-term, because I know fundamentally crypto, we're still going up. The developments are still being made, and I do not ever see crypto just disappearing. It's just going to continue to move forward, even though it may take time, and even though we're going to get a ton more dips and we're going to have some bad days. I know 5 to 10 years from now, this is still very, very early for the overall adoption of cryptocurrency. Now, guys, I really hope you enjoyed today's video. I do have a few announcements coming up. So Wednesday, I am leaving for Austin, Texas for a financial conference called FinCon. I spoke in that conference last year during the whole COVID situation. It was virtual, but this year I am just going as an attendee, and I'm meeting up with some other creators in the space, going for a little business trip, going to eat some good barbecue in Austin, Texas as well, get some few workouts in. So I'm going to try my best to squeeze in time in order to get some of these updates out. It's going to be some bootleg quality. I'm probably just going to bring my MacBook Pro, the one that you guys see right here. I'm just going to record off my webcam, do live streams, because I'm not going to have time to edit, but I want to make sure that you guys do get updated videos. In the off case where I am too busy, regardless of whatever happens in the market, if you guys don't see a video next week, like Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, I will make updates within our Patreon and over on my Instagram, just so you guys are updated and you guys know that I'm not dead. But I will try my best to keep you guys updated. And I also have some backlogged videos from back in May too. I have like the vlog from the Bitcoin conference that I never had the opportunity to upload. So you guys may not even notice me going missing, but I am going to try my best to come out with these uploads. Just want to let you know ahead of time though, why I may not be there. I'm going to be enjoying my time in Austin with a lot of my friends that I haven't seen in quite a bit. Like always, thank you all so much again for checking out this video. If you guys found any type of value, make sure to subscribe, join the Jungie Nation. I try my best to bring you guys the most up-to-date, knowledgeable, easy to digest information on cryptocurrencies over on YouTube. Check me out over on Patreon if you guys want to join my exclusive inner circle. I did open about 30 spots to the group. That's a lot of spots right there. I'm sure it's going to get taken up very quick. So if you guys want to have an opportunity at getting a closer look at my own crypto portfolio, what I do with my watch list, my buy and trade sell alerts, you can join the group down below. In addition to that, don't forget to follow me over on Instagram at Credit Brian. I'm going to be posting some updates on my trip there. I'm going to be also posting some tweets over on Brian Jungie at Twitter, all listed down below in the description. And on top of that, don't forget to check out the links. If you guys don't have a VPN, Surfshark, and check out crypto.com as well, the sponsor for today's video. Thank you all so much again for watching. And until next time, peace out.